Tonight's guest first took the music world by storm almost 20 years ago, and then he was gone. But then, when no one was looking, out of the rubble came a survivor. He's Meatloaf, and he's here. That's you.
Oh, that's, you're right. Well, I was waiting for when I could come in. I didn't know. It was good. I like that.
So now, do I call you Meat? Do I call you
Meat,
Loaf?
Since I was about 9 months, a year old, I've been called Meat.
Really?
My dad did that. And people go, did your dad not like you?
Yeah, thanks, Bob.
And I go, well, when I was a year old, I don't know if he liked me or not. But
were
anyway,
you a big kid? Were you like
I was huge.
Hefty big kid?
I mean, I was, when I weighed, when I was 12 years old, I weigh approximately about 5 pounds more today than I did when I was 12. So I was a big lad, and I was shorter too. So I think that's where they, because Meat, everybody called me Meat. Mm-hmm. So
where'd you grow up?
In Texas. Mm-hmm. See, because if you grow up in the South, that's no, it's not unusual to be called funny names in the
Amen.
South. You know.
Yeah. What happened? Now I read that you in '67.
Yeah.
That's from my
I can't
era.
Wait. I can't wait for
in
this.
In '67, you were the opening act for the Who,
oh,
Iggy
man.
Pop, Johnny
Iggy,
Winter.
Now wait a minute. Wait, I'm gonna stop you for one quick. Iggy opened to us.
Iggy, I beg your pardon.
There you go. It's okay.
And 2 years later, you were working in a parking lot.
But I never got to the parking lot. In the early '60s, the first band was called Meatloaf Soul, and it changed names 3 or 4 times. And in that period of time, we opened that band. Started in California and worked like with Taj Mahal and Janis, Big Brother and Holding Company, all kinds of people. It's like a, you know, fourth act on one of those, you know, festival kind of weird festival bills.
Yeah, that's when they were getting
Oh, man,
good.
It was great.
Great
times. And then we moved into Michigan and opened to like bands like the MC5 and Nugent and Bob Seger, and then Bob Seger would open to us, and it was like, and Alice Cooper would open to us, and then we turned around and opened to Alice Cooper. And we opened to everybody that you can possibly think of that was famous. I've had people give me words, well, how about these guys? Well, I don't know these guys. But anybody that you would have known of in that period of time from Sun Ra. Well, anyway, except for the Jefferson Airplane, the Beatles, and the Rolling Stones. Yeah. So I met a lot of people in that time. And then what happened was the band broke up. I went back to California. And I was trying to put another band together. This is how I got into theater. And my friend, Park, cars at the Aquarius parking lot. Mm-hmm. And he said, look, the guy I'm working with is quitting. Why don't you come down this morning and talk to him? You'll have the job. And he says, we get great tips. He said, why don't you, instead of living where you're living, because he was living in a great house right down the street from Linda Ronstadt. Mm-hmm. And so he said, the guy's moving out. Come and live in there. I said, great, man.
This is 69.
Yeah, this is 69. And so I'm in the parking lot at the Aquarius parking lot on Sunset. And a guy walks up by the name of Greg Carlos, who had the lead in Hair, mm-hmm. playing a character called Burger. Mm-hmm. And he says to me...
Perfect for you, Burger.
Yeah, Burger, but I didn't get that part. He said he was talking to this guy named Barney, and he turned to me and he said, what's your name? And I said, Meat. And he goes, Meat? And I said, yeah, Meatloaf. And he goes, cool. Again, he didn't say, wow, what an unusual name. How'd you get that? You know, it's just like, cool.
Well, so, everyone was named Sunshine and
that's
Dawn,
right. So,
Dawn Morning.
So he goes, what are you doing? I say, I sing. And he says, well, why aren't you auditioning? And there was like a line around the bar. I said, auditioning for what? I said, I'm here to get a job in the parking lot. He says, not come with me. You're a singer. He never heard me sing. He didn't know anything. So he walks in. I walk into the Aquarius Theater. And in the aisle was this guy with really long hair, beads around his neck, down to his knees, laying on this big pillow in the aisle, very 60s, very
surrounded
60s.
Surrounded by girls.
Yeah, surrounded by girls. And so Greg goes up and he goes, and they turn to me and he says, okay, you go up on stage. So I got up on stage and he goes, what are you going to sing for us? And I said, I don't have anything to sing. He said, well, you're here to audition. I said, I'm not here to audition. I'm looking for a job in the parking lot. And they said, well, they said you can sing. And I said, well, he's never heard me singing. He says, do you want to sing or not? And I said, sure. So I turned to the piano player, and I said to the piano player, play a blues in C. And I sang a song called The World Is All Right, It's the People That Make It Bad. And I got through one 12-bar progression of it. They stopped me, and they said, what are you doing tonight? And I said, nothing, parking cars, I hope. And they go, no, we want to give you the job in Hair. And so that night I was watching the show, and I sit there and watch it for 6 weeks, never went into L.A., and eventually went back to Detroit and did it in Detroit. And that's when I had the first After that, I got the first record label, which was Motown in 1970.
Motown 1970. We're going to take a look. Mr. Loaf, we're going to take a look at your clip from There's Not a Dry Eye in
the House. Not a Dry Eye in the House.
My House is the release from Welcome to the Neighborhood.
Yeah.
Let's see that.
I can still see you standing there. Midnight wind blowing through your hair. Remember kisses sweet in the salty air. When love was forever. Turn the page and we fade to blue. The scene has changed, now I'm without you. Well, you just walked away when the act was through.
Splendidly produced.
When I walk into what a video set, I walk in, I say to the crew, look, guys, we don't make videos, we make film.
Yeah.
And you get a different, you just get a different turn, because, you know, guys walk in, and I explain to them, I'm here, I'm not a star.
I want to go back to childhood.
Okay, childhood.
I read that your mother died of cancer when you were 15.
She did? Breast cancer, yeah. She was ill. From the time I was 9, and
you don't remember her?
It was very traumatic when she died. I don't remember going to the funeral, but I've heard stories of the funeral. I don't remember it. And you told me the correct name of it a while ago. What is it?
Traumatic
amnesia. That's very good.
But you remember being young. You remember.
Oh, I remember. Yeah, but you know what? I
can't remember mom in the background there.
I do remember, but I don't remember her face. I mean, I know what she looks like because I have pictures, obviously.
Yeah.
But it's like moments. It's like she's there, but I don't see her. I mean, I see the shape and the form, but it's like there's no pictures with it.
And maybe where a lot of your creative force comes from, because you're putting it to keep it from that rage at her dying.
Yeah, maybe, because and then my father, like I said, was an alcoholic, and I remember that he was, he would go on these binges where he wasn't home. He didn't come home for 3 or 4 days, and I remember as I got older.
This is while she was sick?
Partly when she was sick, before she was sick, and I remember when I got older, because I was so big, that we would go into, because we were from Texas, and he would manage to wind up in the absolutely the worst of the worst redneck bars in existence out between Dallas and Fort Worth, and which is now, kind of grown up.
High-rises.
But back then, I mean, it was like, and if you drive by, you've driven, everybody has driven past these places, unless you go in there and freak with them, they're scary looking.
Roadhouses,
they're scary looking. You'll be driving down the road and you'll want to get something to eat, and you go, I don't think we're going in there, babe. Well, it's those kind of places where everybody says, I don't think we should go in there. That's where he was. And I remember as a kid going into these places. I mean, my mother would go in and I'd say, no, I'm going in. And I remember this.
Pull him out.
Yeah. And I would go in and they'd give me a hard time. And I would just stand up to them, probably scared to death. And in fact, I was scared to death. But I remember that. I don't remember moments necessarily, but I remember feelings of walking up to guys, when I was like 10 years old, 11 years old, who were drunk and bigger than me, but I was big. Mm-hmm. And I would just look at them and go, don't mess with me. Mm-hmm. You're going to get hurt. You mess with me. I mean, that was my attitude. Yeah. I mean, that's
rock world.
Yeah. And that's kind of, that's kind of my rock attitude now when I take the stage. Don't mess with me, son. You're mine. You're mine. That's what I do when I walk on stage, too. I look at them. I go, they don't hear me. They don't hear me, but I go from side to side, and I look at them, I go, you're mine. You're mine. You're going down. I feel like Muhammad Ali before a fight.
Did you left home? What happened when you...
Oh, well, the day after my mom's funeral, I was in the house with one of my good friends who still lives in Dallas and I've seen in the last couple of years. And we were just sitting in the house by ourselves. I had on a pair of gym shorts and a T-shirt. And my dad, I hadn't seen him for a couple of days, and he comes in, and he was drunk, and he started screaming, "Get all these women out of the house," and there was nobody in the house. I mean, there was, he was like, "Get all these women out of my house." He was like, gone.
Yeah.
And
dementia.
So Billy just said, "Well, I better go." I said, "Yeah, it's a good idea," and I just told him to shut up, you know, and said, I'm going to my room. Next thing you know, he kicks open my door. He's got a butcher knife, and he just plants it. And I mean, I'm rolling, and he plants it right into the bed.
Yikes!
And
Dad's off.
Oh,
way
and
off.
So then I ran out of the room, and he came after me, and I just apparently I didn't know this, but this is the aftermath. Apparently, I mean, I fought back like crazy. I broke his nose and four ribs, and you know, went after him because I thought he was going to kill me. So
yeah,
then I left home. It was over.
You were in the Broadway production of Rocky Horror Show.
Oh,
then
I was.
Then you did the movie.
Yeah, I did it in L.A. first, which was at the Roxy.
Yeah, what? Why do you think that popularity? I mean, was everyone, of course, not expecting it to become this gigantic deal, right?
Well, it's funny because when we were in L.A., see, I think everybody thought it was going to be a big deal.
Did.
See, all the 20th Century Fox and all the producers and the director, everybody thought it was going to be a big deal.
When they did the movie, because it had been such a big Broadway scene.
Well, it didn't do well in New York. And the reason it didn't do well was because they tried to bring it in here as this big giant thing. They said, "Give our regards to Broadway, tell them we're on our way," and made this big splash.
Mistake, because nothing's bigger than New York.
Oh, boy, and the critics in New York did not like it. They went, "Oh, yeah, well, we'll show you, you little upstart." And we only ran for like 5-6 weeks here. We're in L.A., it ran for a long time. It's still running everywhere. But in L.A., it was a cult thing, and it was like people like Keith Moon would come in, Keith Moon, the drummer with The Who, and you'd know when Keith Moon was there because there'd be 9 bottles of champagne across the front of the stage.
Because he'd drink while he...
Oh, Keith was, he was as wild as they get, but he was like a little lovable kind of little thing. I've been around the block, Lauren, let me tell you.
What's the biggest cobblestone turned up? Going around the block. That your best rock story.
I don't even know.
I can't think of them.
Yeah, I mean, it's just like, you know, I go back, you know, like I said, hanging out with Roger Daltrey and Joplin. I mean, I went because I was kind of, I'm very shy. Like I think most performers inside are shy, but at the same time we're like very, you know, extroverted So when I had the opportunity to go and meet these people like Janis Joplin or Dr. John in the 60s or Sun Ra or whoever or Jagger or whoever, I'll go. I mean, I'm not afraid of them. I'm more afraid of actors. But rock guys, I'm never afraid of. I want to go meet them. And when I get there, I have absolutely nothing to say to them. I have nothing in common. Because in the old days, I tended to live in the 70s and the 60s. And, you know, so I was one of those guys that would wear the lampshade on his head proudly, okay? I had no...
And then you decided to put down the lampshade. And when did you take it off?
Well,
because you quit for a while.
Well, I did, you know, because I still believe it is, and I still believe this. Do you remember the old Mickey Rooney, Judy Garland movies?
Yeah.
Where the guy, Mickey, would go, you know, they need to do something, and they'd be sitting around, and Mickey would be going...
Show in the barn.
Yeah, well, but the guy, it would go like this. It'd be four guys, and they'd all go, and one would go, "Hey, I got some lights." And Mickey go, "That's good, that's good." And Judy Garland would come up on this side of him and go, "And I could sing that song that Bill wrote. Yeah, that's right." And the other guy would go, "I've got a barn." And Mickey would go, "Let's put on a show." And it would be like that. And that was it. And the next thing you know, they got this big, huge show going on in this barn.
That's what happened here.
That's right. It's exactly the same thing. Only everybody's in black around here. I don't know. I thought I was in the crew today.
So what happened?
So that's what I thought. This was.
Yeah.
I mean, that's really how I think this is. That's how I think everything is. That's how I think, that's my vision.
When you have a good time and you can't create.
And then all of a sudden I figured out it wasn't. Bat Out of Hell today has sold about 32 million records. So, I, you know, some people say it's the third biggest seller. I know it's in the top six, five, whatever. So, but what I learned then was it wasn't about the work. It wasn't that, that
stop
I was...
Stop being about the work.
It's, well, and it always, work. It never was about the work. And I, to me, it was about the work, and it was about, at one point to me, it was about proving I was right, okay? So that kind of, that'll destroy you too. When you've got to prove so hard that you're right when everybody says you're wrong, but you know you're right. And so, and instead of just like doing it calmly, I did it, not violently, but very aggressively. And so that kind of, I don't have that kind of, I'm not that aggressive. So that kind of went against, that was a sandpaper against my personality. Mm-hmm. And basically in 1984, I just said, okay, I'm just gonna act. And so I started, you know, because once you go away from that, it's, you really have to, you know, it's like starting over. You have to start over. Anytime you go away from records, you have to start over. Anytime you go away from doing
movies,
film or,
any,
or theater or anything else, you have to start over. You know, you have an advantage in the fact that you've done it before and that you were good, and or at least I think I'm good. Mm-hmm. I think I'm very good, Lauren. Thank you very much.
Yes.
And so, so you have that advantage and you have that experience to go, but you have to start over. And then in 1984, a guy named David Simone, who was from England, came to me and said, look, we'd really like you to record again. And I said, well,
you're good, come out.
I don't know. I said, I don't know. And he says, let me tell you, you can do whatever you want. All I want you to do is just go record for me. He said, I'm not going to tell you what to do. I'm not going to send anybody in the studio. You do what you want. He said, if it's bad, it's bad. If it's good, it's good. If it sells records, it sells records. If it doesn't, it doesn't. If nobody likes it, nobody likes it.
You've been waiting to hear that. Been with your wife for 20 years.
Yeah.
She's been putting up with your rock and roll world, huh?
Yeah. I've been putting up with hers.
Yeah.
You know,
well,
she,
what is hers?
Because she worked for Albert Grossman. She worked.
Mm.
She worked for
Beatles.
Albert. She worked with Janis later on with what's the Boogie Band or whatever that was called. She worked with them. She worked with the band. She
so
worked.
So that's
with,
how you guys met. You met in rock and roll.
She was
here.
Yeah. She was work. She was managing the studio. We cut Bat Out of Hell at.
What about sex? Have your daughters asked you? You have two teenage daughters. Have they asked you about sex? How did that work out?
Oh, they my wife talked to them.
You just aborted that subject.
No,
stay clear of that.
I've dealt with them on.
Threaten
no,
my boyfriends.
I have. You know, it's we have. We both have. And you know, their reply is, Dad, come on. Do we really need to talk about that? But mostly, well, I tell you what, I've dealt with them. My wife has dealt with them. She dealt with them in a great way. You know, she's taken him to the gynecologist. She's done the right thing. She goes, and she said, look, she's not going to pass. We're not, you know, yeah, we're not, because we, first of all, you don't really want to, it's like a weird thing. You don't want a teenager who's pregnant. So,
yeah, I know.
And I, because sex is what sex is, it's going to happen. And so you just, You see that you can't be uptight, and there's too many people that are uptight, like too many dads and moms that are uptight. And my daughter can't have sex. I got news for you, Frank. She's gonna have sex,
yeah,
okay,
no,
babe?
Yeah, but yeah, the
bottom
more you
line,
are like so, that, the more she's gonna be doing it.
That's exactly right. And then what happens
the
is if
you
if you go to this whole other side of it,
give her some responsibility.
Yeah, you.
Maybe
but you teach her safe sex. You you know, you don't want them to get pregnant. Mm. You don't condemn them. You don't say, you know, you say we love you. We love you. Love is the key word to that. That's the communication. And so the little one who's 15 says, she says, no, I don't need to go to the doctor. I told you, I'm not going to have sex till I'm married. Now, nobody's said that to her. That's her moral standard.
Yeah, or her decision at the moment. She might change her mind
on
that.
Yeah, she could change her mind. I'm ready for it at any moment.
They're going to skin you alive for talking about their sex lives on TV.
Yeah,
you know that.
But it's late night, and they're going to be asleep.
Well, I think you're a cool dad. Cool daddy. Cool daddy, put it there. We used to say, Daddy, you
always think somebody told me that Dick Cavett took one of these grapes
and smashed
it.
Don't, please don't.
I'm not going to, but okay. They said I could do anything I wanted to with a grape, so this is what I want to do. Oh, I missed. Wait, one minute, I got to get it right here. Oh, shoot.
You're
going
too high.
Oh, I had
very
it.
Close.
This is take three.
Whoa!
There you go.
Yeah.
There you go.
Very
that's
good.
What I wanted to do with the grape.
Well, you did that very well.
Well.
So, good night. Come back and see us another time.
Bye.